Hello, and welcome back to my garage. Today, and tomorrow, and probably the day after that, I'm going to work on the Skoda Felicia Fun. The reason is it failed the annual safety check. Yeah, the annual safety check is just a thing. Sometimes the car goes through it with nothing, and sometimes you've got a whole list, and the list is quite big. Some things are quite easy, other things take a little bit longer time, like that welding stuff. So I need to do both ball joints. One side of the CV joint is leaking. That's really odd because last year I replaced both sides with just new ones complete. I didn't do it myself. So probably there was too much grease in there from the factory. It's something that can happen, of course. So that's something we have to look at. One of the brake hoses is bad. And I, of course, have some new ones. And I do both sides of them and the one at the back. But I thought there was one at the back, but of course there are two. So I have to order a second one. I want to do just refresh all of them. Like I said, the welding of the side sills underneath the doors, it's just a common place for most cars to get, well, crusty there. And this is definitely no exception. Yeah, that's it. So the list, it's pretty long. A couple of things are just easy, and there are two major things. One, the welding. Maybe I will put it in a separate video. I don't know exactly how I going to make that something educational. Right here on the list is not only the one brake line, but they say the whole steel lines are corroded, and I do remember cleaning them off a couple of years ago and just recoated them, but there is a point that you cannot hide it anymore. It's just something you have to do. These are your brakes, and especially if I didn't like my girlfriend, I didn't care, but of course I do like my girlfriend, and I want her to be safe. So yeah, brakes, that's what we're going to talk about. So I don't know exactly how I'm going to shoot this video. I'm thinking I'm going to show you how to make your own brake lines. First of all, the brake lines I'm going to use is Conifer or copper nickel. And this is just a alloy that's used on some modern cars. It is a, like I said, a hybrid between nickel and copper. This is a copper tube. I choose Conifer over copper because it is more rigid. It is, especially if you're in this car, I could use copper, no problems. It's not a high performance car. It is on your older vehicles, copper is just fine. But as soon as you are having like ABS, not that this car has ABS, but then I strongly suggest going with Conifer or just steel. The copper is a lot softer than a Conifer of the copper nickel is. And also the copper nickel doesn't rust. The reason I don't use copper on high performance vehicles is I have seen them split. And not when they're new, but when they're just a couple of years old, they get, how do you call it? They become brittle. If you just nick it a little bit, then they're going to tear. And what I've seen happen, maybe due to a vibration or something, but I have seen split them open. Some of the downsides of the copper nickel is that it's a lot harder, and it's not as easy as to work with than the copper. Also, the copper nickel can use it with a simple tool like this one beneath it, but it is a lot harder. And because I am going to do a whole car, I especially bought a new tool for that, and I will show you that later. the tools you definitely need if you want to make the lines yourself is at least one of these tools. I know you can get knockoff of this tool. This is one of Midlock. My dad bought this tool, I think, maybe 25 years ago on a big car market, and he came home with it. I think it was something around 300 or 400 guilders. Yeah, we had guilders back then. Now we have the lousy euro. But okay, another discussion. I'm not going to talk politics here. In today's money, I don't think with inflation and something like that, but it will probably be costing around 300 euros in today's money. 350 or 400 US dollars, something in that range. So, but I know if you are looking on the internet, you can find these kits for, I think, about 30 US dollars, 40 US dollars. I don't know how the quality is of those, but if you just do a couple of them, I think you're just fine. There is just one big problem with this. This is just, it's a bit of hit or miss. If you use this tool a lot, then you can make some great flanges with this tool, no problem. But if you're a beginner at this tool, you're going to have a hard time your first couple of tries. So be sure that you, before going to make your own lines, just make a couple of them, just get a good feeling for this tool. Of course, I will show you in a moment how this tool works. You only can make SAE kinds of flares with this tool. And that's the double and the single flare. So if you want to make DIN flares, then this definitely is not the tool for you. But in the past, I did use SAE disc flare system on DIN systems. And it most of the time works just fine. But then again, it's not the way to do it, of course. But if you are in a pickle, that's up to you. Some of the guys out there really hate this tool, and I do understand why. But then again, if it saves you, then in my book it's a good tool. And because this is a heritage for me, it's definitely not going away. So it's going back into the closet. This is a tool I just bought for this project. Not, of course, only for this project. I have the Corolla, and the Corolla needs also new brake lines. I have a Alpha 75, and that thing also needs new brake lines underneath the whole car. And now this one needs also brake lines underneath the whole car. Even though it's doable with that other tool, but now I just had a good reason to buy them. But for you, if you just need to do 1, 2, or 3, maybe even 10, then you probably don't going to buy this unit. This is the cheapest, at least I could find on the internet, and it was about 150 euros, so around the $200 mark. Yeah, it was pretty cheap. I was a bit skeptical, of course, because the most of them were around 300 euros. So, but this tool just works fine. I, of course, tested it already. Brake lines are not my favorite job to do, but maybe it now is. This thing is a revolver style, and this one can do only the 4.75 or the 316 lines. Those lines are what I'm using most of the time, so I don't have any use for bigger lines. Also, I'm going to show you this tool in a moment, how it works. But that is a tool, one of the two tools you definitely need to have if you want to make your own brake lines. Another tool you definitely want to have is a pipe cutter. This is a really big one, but you have also those smaller ones that are just working just fine. This is what I have, and this is what I'm going to use. Just be sure that you have one of these. And I, in my case, I'm going to use one of these masturbation sleeves. I know it's really a childish thing to call it like that, but It does look like one. It just handles like one, so I call it a masturbation sleeve. Moving on. This thing makes your lines just as straight as an arrow. If you use one of these, it's going to look really great. So, just a small demonstration. And of course, kinking it. Even this tool, if you kink the line, you don't get the kinks out of there. You see just a little bit of a wave in there. But just for demonstration purposes, I'm going to use this line and slide it on there. And just it even makes the same sound. Huh? And just like that, it is almost straight. But as you have, maybe you can see, because I kinked it on a couple of places, it isn't as straight as we want it to be. So, then again, if you look at it like so, it looks pretty damn straight to me. It's nice to have, but these things are pretty expensive, and it isn't necessary. So if it's just a fix and you want to do it, don't buy this one. Just invest it in a better flaring tool than in one of these. Another tool you definitely want to use is pipe wrenches. Don't start working on your car, or at least at brakes, if you don't have these pipe wrenches. These can be also be very cheap. Buy one of a set of these, at least buy one for your car. Most of them are 10 or 11, sometimes 12, but most of the time 10, 11, you have millimeters is what you want, at least for in Europe. I don't know about Americans, but you have to figure that out for yourself, because I don't have that much experiences with American cars. First of all, you need to know what kind of system your car is using. Is it DIN or is it SAE? SAE is commonly known as single flare or double flare. I will get into that later. And DIN is most of the time called a bubble flare. But of course, those are just terms and people get those two confused. So let me show you the difference between DIN and SAE. I think these two are the most common you can find on your car. Most of the time on European cars you can find DIN. I know that Japanese cars most of the time uses SAE. It's not a rule, of course, but that is my experience with brake lines. So even though these two have the same fret pitch, they even use the same wrench. I believe these two are 11 millimeters. They have the same fret pitch, and of course they use the same kind of tube. It's a 4.75 or 3/16, and I never ever found a car that uses an other diameter than this. They're probably out there, but I doubt they're really common. Probably you can find bigger diameters on trucks and maybe some heavy equipment, but most of the time cars you will find this tube, this 4.75 or 3/16. But back to the flares. As you can see, they're about the same height, and as I've said, they're practically the same, and this will just fret in a hole meant for this guy and vice versa. But there are differences. Yeah, not only the color in this case, but there are a bigger difference. If you look closely, I cannot zoom in any further than this, so hopefully you can see it. As you can see, the ridge here is a little bit thinner than the ridge there. So, because this has a little bit of a chamfer to the inside, this is the SAE. And because this one is flat on the top, this one is thin. So be sure that you get your right flare nuts with your system. So if it has a chamfer on the inside, it is SAE. If it is flat, as you can see that this one is, then is it thin. And also this one is thin. This is a female end, and this is also SAE. You cannot see it, but it also has a chamfer on the inside. So I put two pipes right here, and one of course is just copper, and the other is a copper nickel alloy. And if you look closely, you see there, well, probably you think those are the same flares, but they're not. And it's really hard to see from the front side. From the front side, they look pretty much the same, except for that this hole is a little bit thinner, but don't pay attention to that. But as you can see, they're domed at the top and they're almost looking the same. But if I tilt it a little bit, and you probably can see it also right now, this one is chamfered at the bottom and this one is flat. So now it's up to you which one is which. SAE, DIN. This is the DIN flare nut, and as you can see, they're just working just fine. And this is the SAE, and as you can see, it's just sitting flush just about at the ridge as they should be. And this is the SAE with the DIN nut, and as you can see, it's almost looking the same. So would you have a problem using this one? In my experiences, no. But you can get issues. And issues are most likely to be lines leaking. 9 out of 10 times you just use this and no problems at all. But it is that one time you unable to get it, stop it leaking. So just be cautious with that. Well, we do know now that this is the DIN. This is the SAE, commonly known as the single flare. And this is the SAE, commonly known as the double flare. Also, the double flare has that trumpet shape, tapered shape on the end. Most of the time what you see is, at least on Japanese cars, is that they use the double flare on all their lines. This is a double flare with nut. As you can see, it has the taper on the back end. It's not as good visible anymore as it was, because this one has been crushed, and when you are tightening it up, it crushes itself, so it sits nice and doesn't leak. So, but you can still see there is a little bit of a taper at the back. And also, if you look at the nut, it has a taper on the inside. Most of the time in Japanese cars, you find this. This one is from a Suzuki, but other Japanese cars use this system also. Most of them use it like this. This is one from the Skoda Felicia. And as you can hopefully see, let me clean it up a little bit. It is just straight on the bottom, and they have a mushroom kind of style. And also, if you see the nut, it is flat. And this is how you use the double and the single flare system. Your double and the single flare is just fitting in together just nicely. And when you just take these and you screw them together, they make a nice seal. There are cases that you just want to repair a piece of pipe, maybe the end pipe, and then you're going to use one of these. But also, in my case with the Felicia, the two lines from the front to the back were, of course, one piece, but I wasn't able to get it out of the car and in of the car in one piece. Stuff like that happens, and or I needed to remove the whole subframe and stuff like that, that it was just too much work in my opinion. And then I also use one of these connection flares. To use one of these tools, it's really handy to use it in a vise. Of course, you can use it underneath the car also, but it can be a little bit of a pain. So you know what kind of system your car is using. And the problem is, at least with this tool, this one can only do SAE. I don't know if these sets come within DIN, but they probably do. So first of all, don't forget your flare nut. It happens. It even happens to me on the Felicia. All we need to make sure that it's a clean cut on the tube, and we deburr it with our tool. And this one is just nicely done. And you, of course, use one of these pipe cutters for that. Then use the right hole for the tube. And of course, this is the first one. It's also mentioned on the tool itself. Now we need to be sure we pick the right die. And this is the die for the 4.75. So this is the die we use. And first of all, we need to know how far the tube has to be in the tool. And as you can see, there is a little ridge right here. That first ridge. If you place it next to the pipe, the pipe has to be at the same height as the ridge. And after you've done that, you just close up the first one, and then you close up the second one, and then you make sure it's really, really tight in there. It does happen when you're using the tool, the pipe is slipping, so we don't want that, but it is pretty common, so don't worry about it if it happens. It just happens. So now we use this inside here, but before that, just use a little bit of grease on here. Just some normal bearing grease, nothing special. It just helps the tool forming a nice flare. Next up, we need to install this one, so we have to, and then you can hook it just like so. But here we go. So let's turn this until the die is completely flush with the tool. And then back it up. And as you can see, we now have a single flare. So if you want to have a single flare, then you can just stop. But if you want to do a double flare, you have just to use this tool. This is copper, and it is the softest kind of line you can use. So don't over tighten it. But this is something you have to get a feeling for, so don't worry too much. So let's have a look. Does it look good? Yeah, it does look good in my opinion. So if it's still a little bit too shallow, then just press it again. And now we can remove it. Always this one first and then you can lever it outwards. And as you can see, we now have a double flare. But maybe as you have seen, it isn't the most prettiest in round kind of flare. And that is just a little bit of a problem with this tool. You can, if you're really careful and preparation is right, you can make really beautiful flares with this tool. But it is not uncommon that you end up with some bugged ones. So this tool needs, you do need a little bit of practice with this tool. But as you have seen, it works, and it works just fine. So if you just have to do a couple of flares, then just buy one of these tools. It works at best with copper. If you use a conifer or copper nickel, it's a lot harder. So let's try that. Of course, I'm not using a nut right now, but just let's see how well it works. I do believe that our copper nickel, it's still doable, but it is a lot harder on the tool. And again, just a little dab of grease, not too much. But in this case, especially with the harder materials, grease is really a priority. As you have seen, this isn't really a fast process, but it is doable. So this one, be sure it's all tight. Be sure you have a good look if it's indeed bottomed out. And it looks bottomed out now. Well, it looks just fine. So let's make it a double flare. Not too bad. The taper isn't as visible as on the stock one, but it's definitely there. So this one is also working just fine. But as soon as you're going to steel and stainless steel, especially stainless steel, well, this one is really going to have a hard time. It's not impossible, but most of the time of day, the flares just don't come out as well as they should. These are the more professional tools, the revolver style flaring tools. As you can see, it has a couple of dies. There are also a couple of blanks. You can add more dies if you want to. But more dies means more expensive, and those are dies I never ever used in the past, so why should I care buying them? But if you do have a look at the dies itself, this one is for DIN, it's just one operation, and these two are two operations for the single and of course the double flare. In this case, the operation is quite easy. You just need to be sure that you use the right die block with the die. So in this case, we are going to make a DIN, and it's nicely labeled on the die block itself. So be sure that you throw in the right one. So you insert the pipe, and then you have to be sure that it is flush with the dye block. And I mean flush, if you look over it, it is flush and you don't see something sticking out. There are revolver style that have some kind of a zeroing out position. This one doesn't have that. It is too bad, but we have what we have. So, and that maybe is one of the reasons it's a bit cheaper than the other ones, but still my eyes work just well. That is not really a problem. So, of course we need to use the right dye, in this case the DIN. But also, like always, just a little bit of grease on there to help it out. We choose the right dye and be sure that it's lined up correctly, and it does. And now it's just a matter of pulling on the lever until it doesn't go any further. And we let go. And remove the dye. And right here, we have our flare. And this is of course a DIN flare because it has a flat bottom. And it is the same process if we want to use a SAE. We need of course the right dies or die blocks, and we need to use the right die. I added already a bit of grease. Be sure we use the right die, in this case operation 1 for SAE. Don't forget to tighten up the block. Be sure that it lines up correctly. Just give it a little bit of a yank. And now we successfully did a single flare. So if we remove it now from the block, as you can see, we have now a single flare. Now we move to the next die. It's operation 2 of the SAE. This one is a little bit more difficult to pull off. You have to work a little bit harder. This thing makes your life a lot easier when you have to do a lot of flares. But this one you cannot use underneath your car. At least it's going to be a really big hassle. And that other one, it is a hassle, but you can do it underneath the car. You have special tools for underneath the car. Most of the time those are hydraulics. It is something I not have the use for yet, but it's definitely somewhere at the bottom of my wish list. First of all, we have to measure this pipe because we don't want to have a lot of extra that we have to throw away in the bin or something. We want to be as economical as possible. And the way I do it is just with a piece of string. So I'm just going to trace the whole thing with a piece of string. And this is roughly what we need. Of course, I am going to add a little bit of luck, just in case, but a little bit is enough. Then we get our tubing. I choose for the copper nickel in this case. So we have to unroll our roll. And normally you have to do it by hand and try to get it as straight as possible. And as you can see, it is not impossible to do it with your hands to make it decently straight. But of course, I've got my masturbator and it works just so much better. So let's just measure out with your rope and cut it. It feels like it's a bit much, but oh well. Also, what you want to do is, before cutting your pipe, is to make sure that there are no dents or dings or any fabrication errors in this tube. It did happen to me that there are just some dings, maybe from storage, maybe I stepped on it myself, who knows, but it did happen. And it will be a shame if you put a lot of effort in them and then you are halfway bending and you see that there is just a nick right here and it is not usable, so you can better check your pipe before that. So we do know we need to use DIN. I always start with placing a flange on one side. Now it doesn't matter if you are forgetting your flange nut, but it's a good practice to just put it on there. We use DIN. DIN, this one. And after that, we are going to start bending. Like I said before, I don't have a bending tool. And this is what I commonly use, just a socket or just this ridge where the pipe is sitting of a spray can, but this one is just way too fat. And normally I use one of those smaller ones from a deodorant or something like that. But I don't have one, I at least couldn't find one. So back to the socket. It works just fine, at least with copper and conifer. If you are trying to bend it with steel or stainless, the chances are that you get flat spots or just kink the whole tube. It is possible, but you have to be very careful. So I choose in this case a socket 27. And the reason why I chose it is if I just lay it here in one of these bends, it just sits perfectly flush. Well, almost perfectly flush. So, first bend. It sounds obvious, but and it is, but you just lay it next to your dummy piece. What I like to do is just mark the beginning of the bend, just where it starts to wander off. So something like that. Where I put my point is the direction of the bend. So I put it on top of here because the bend has to go, in this case, 90 degrees downward. Of course, in this stage, it doesn't matter because if I put it like so, so or so, it doesn't matter at all. What I have here is just a mark on the socket itself. I just have a mark and I line it up with my mark on my pipe. And the next thing is the most crucial. You don't want to press both sides at the same time. So press it like so. The reason is you bent it on this side and on that side. And then your radius is completely off. So what I do is just put my hand on one side and bend it only on the other side around the tube, and we need about a 90 degree. It's a bit, as you can see, it is a bit too much. The easiest way is just to stretch on both ends, and as you can see, we have now a perfect 90. Well, perfect. If you have gone a little bit too far with your bending, you can just, by pulling on both sides, bit like this, you can just straighten it all up, no problem. But if you want to put a little bit more of a bend in that, don't do it like this, because you will kink it or you get a really weird kind of bend in there. So back to the socket and just bend it a little bit more. But this is our first bend, and let's see if I screwed it up. It looks fine to me. So, and now we are going to lay it as close as we can next to the original. Don't worry if it's a little bit crooked or off. We can also always adjust it a little bit. So, start of the bend is right here. And this one also has to go straight down. So put it on there. Bend it, it's a 90 degree. Close enough. And as you can see, we're just following the template. This is a bit of a weird turn, but nothing to worry about. So, like I said, I put a dot on the place I need to bend it. And that would be around, somewhere like here. Just try to get it as close as possible. Don't nitpick about a millimeter or something off. It will be fine. Okay. Something like this. Nope, we need a bit more. We still need a little bit more. I overshoot a little bit, so just pull on both ends, not try to bend it, just pull just like so. Well, I do think this is about right. As you can see, our radius is a little bit different than this one, but that doesn't bother me too much. So I lay it again on top of the pipe. As you can see, it is about right. So next up, we need to do this bend, and it has to go somewhere like this. Is a bit of a weird bend, so I have to take it out of the vise a bit. It should be about parallel with that other one. D this should be something in the neighborhood. Yeah, it's looking pretty okay. So I lay it on top again, and we need to bend it like so. And the radius is about, or the bend is about to start right here. Yeah, something like that. Sometimes you have to place your socket somewhere different because, well, now I at least can bend it. It's not the most comfortable way of doing it, but sometimes you must do what you have to do. I need to bend it a little bit more. As you can see, you can still tweak it a little bit. Nothing to worry about that. Okay, now there's something important. If I'm going to bend this, I will not be able to get this flare on there. At least not with my new tool. With an old tool, I probably could. But it will be very difficult. What we're going to do is, we're going to measure this, cut our pipe to length, put a flare nut on there, then the flare, and after that we're going to bend the last piece. And then just try to roll it. And just be sure that you get a little bit extra, because of course of the flare, it's going to compress a little bit. Looks fine to me. There is already some grease on there. What did I forget? Yeah, I almost forgot. It's really easy to forget those flare nuts, so is in its place, yes. So now we have to do is measure up our last bend. Also, be sure before you bend it, be sure that the nut is on the right side. And now we have to bend it like so. These short bends are the hardest because you don't have any leverage, of course. So a bending tool there is going to be really great to have. Well, this is about it. Looks pretty similar, right? Of course, I cannot stack them really well together. So let's put it on the car. I did pick up a other hose from a local shop, so we can replace it all at the same time. And it's really easy to get it in. Couple of taps and it will be in there. I don't know if we can install our freshly bent thing with the others in the way, but let's try. Sometimes you're just better off doing it in the right order. You don't have to tighten these things up like a maniac. They're just snug and then just a little. Thank you. Now be sure that the lines are not rubbing against each other, so be sure you look underneath the car, and as you can probably see here, it is leaning here on the axle. Just like that, it's now nice and free, so if it vibrates, it doesn't vibrate on the metal, so it doesn't rub a hole in the new lines. So now it's for me just a matter of filling it up, bleeding the brakes, and we're done. Hopefully. And that's it. Hopefully you know now a little bit more about brake flares and what kind of brake systems are out there. I know I started this video as a replacing all the brake lines of the, of course, the Skoda Felicia Fun, but I think to make it a little bit more universal, it is becoming a little bit of a better video. I show you how to bend your pipes, how to make your flares with the different kind of tools. So yeah, there's nothing more to it. I did replace all the brake lines from the Skoda Felicia, and one of the front lines was bad, but if I take a closer look, I cannot find anything wrong with it. But either way, I did replace it all, and now at least the brake lines are up to snuff. We already did the front brakes in a separate video, and also the rear brakes we did it. So the only brake item I didn't replace on this car ever are, I believe, the wheel cylinders and the master cylinder, and of course the brake calipers at the front. But for the rest, everything is new. Well, new. So that's it for today's video. I hope you enjoyed it, or at least learned something from it. And if you did, please give it a like. If you want to follow me around, you know what to do. And I will see you next time. Bye.